Okay, so in this video, we're just going to kind of condense and talk very briefly about some of the things that weren't covered in the disease-specific videos relating to the cardiac system and some of the things you just really need to know. So this is going to bring about a lot of kind of eclectic. It's going to seem a little bit random, but we're going to talk about the things that you really need to know for NCLEX just as quick points, okay? So first of all, heart rate. What is a normal heart rate? Well, we all know that normal heart rate is 60 to 100. Sinus tachycardia is going to be over 100 beats per minute, and sinus bradycardia is going to be less than 60 beats per minute. And the way we're obviously going to assess that is going to be through our EKG. We're going to have our P, Q, R, S, and T. This is going to be one complete cardiac cycle. This is the mechanical representation of one complete cardiac cycle. And we're looking, hoping that our patients are between 60 to 100 beats per minute. That's going to be normal. Sinus tach again is going to be greater than 100. Sinus brady is going to be less than 60. Okay. Now, very quickly, let's talk about the vascular system. Hopefully, this is not new information for you at all, but our vascular system consists of arteries and veins, and then there's venules, there's arterioles, and there's capillaries. Okay. So basically, we have our heart, and coming out of our heart is going to be arteries. And then we're going to go to arterioles, which are going to be a little bit smaller. And then we're going to have this capillary network, okay, within different organs. And then we're going to have our venules. And then we're going to have our veins bringing it back to the heart. Easiest way to remember this is arteries take blood away. And venules or veins bring blood back. I remember that because I learned Spanish back in the day. And viene means to come. So viene comes back to the heart. A for away, arteries, and then again you have your arterioles, and then this is going to be our capillary bed. And the capillary network is really what's going to be within organs. So like, for example, here's a kidney, or pancreas, there's a kidney right there. Then you're also going to have, of course, your liver, and those are all going to be have all these capillary or these arteries and veins, and within those, that's where your capillary is going to branch out and perfuse all those different areas. Again, here's lungs, of course. And so on this picture here, the red is going to indicate arteries, and your blue is going to indicate a vein. Okay, here's your aorta, and then here's your vena cava. Okay, so that's a very simple overview of the vascular system. Now, when we have a patient who is suspected of having a heart attack, one thing we're going to run is we're going to run what are called cardiac markers. Another way to refer to this is going to be CIPs, cardiac injury profile. Okay, cardiac injury profile is going to be a set of a few labs that we run to determine the extent or the presence of cardiac damage. That's going to consist of troponin, and it's going to be troponin I and troponin T, CKMB, and myoglobin. I know we talked about this in our myocardial infarction lecture, but very briefly, troponin is going to be your most sensitive to cardiac damage. However, it takes about 12 hours to peak. Your CKMB is going to be a little bit less sensitive, and it takes a little bit longer than your troponins. Myoglobin, very low specificity to infarction, because this can indicate damage to muscles in general. It does peak the fastest, but very low specificity. So the number we're really going to be concerned about is our troponins. And most of all, I mean, in my hospital, the number we're really looking at is our troponin I. Okay, if our troponin I is elevated, then that's an indicative of infarction. Okay, and especially if we can match that up with an EKG. If we have an EKG that shows like an ST elevation and we have troponins that are elevated, the patient is having a heart attack. If they have a non-STEMI, but we have our elevated troponins, we can also determine that they may be having a heart attack. Some cardiac labs. These are going to be some of the labs you're going to be concerned about with cardiac damage. First of all, is going to be potassium. Our normal potassium is 3.5 to 5. We know that hypokalemia, so less than 3.5, can lead to ventricular dysrhythmias, increased digoxin toxicity if your patient is receiving digoxin. It can develop a U-wave. Now what a U-wave is it's, let's say here's our normal, and then there'll be an additional wave here. This is going to be our U-wave, and this can show up with hypokalemia. This can also lead to ST depression. Again, ST depression, here's our, oops. So ST depression is gonna look like that. So Q, R, S, and T. So instead of ever really coming up, it's just gonna go below our isoelectric line, and that's gonna be ST depression. Hyperkalemia can lead to peaked T waves. So what you'll see with your patient is it'll have like a T wave that's very high. It may be almost even as high as your QRS. And then you'll also have the widened QRS, and then it can lead to ventricular dysrhythmias as well. And again, if this QRS continues to widen, that's gonna lead to severe ventricular arrhythmias, and then you'll have your peaked T waves. So what I would do, if you have a patient who's on like a 5-lead continuous cardiac monitoring or whatever, if you start noticing that these T waves are elevating, and you know, because your normal T wave is gonna be way down here, if you notice that this T wave starts to elevate, what I would do is I would just kind of call a physician, say, hey, you know, I noticed the EKG is getting a little bit funky. We're getting these changes in the T wave. Do you mind if I run, just get like a CBC or and a BMP, you know? Another lab we're gonna look at is hematocrit. Hematocrit is basically percent of RBCs in the blood. It's different for males and females, but as that number goes up, as our percent of red blood cells goes up, that's gonna be indicative of dehydration. Why is that? Well, if, you know, part of our blood, only a portion of our blood is red blood cells. As you can see here, it's 30 to 50% or so. And the rest is gonna be different fluids and things. So if that continues to go up, you know, and we're at 60 for our hematocrit, that's gonna mean there's less of the other fluids, which shows that, you know, we are dehydrated. On the other end, if our hematocrit goes down, hemoglobin goes down, that could be indicative of anemia. Another lab you're gonna wanna look at for your cardiac patients is gonna be lipids. This is gonna be total cholesterol you want to have under 200 milligrams per deciliter. LDLs, that's our bad cholesterol, you want it under 130. HDLs, happy, which are high density lipoproteins, you want that between 30 and 70, and that's the good cholesterol, okay? A couple other labs I didn't write on here, but I want you to remember, are gonna be BNP. I know we talked about this with heart failure. That's brain natriuretic peptide. And what happens with that is as the ventricles stretch, as there's increased ventricular stretch, it's gonna release BNP into the system. Normal value should be under 100. You may notice patients with heart failure have levels 4,000 and above. But anytime we get up over 100, that's gonna be indicative of ventricular stretch and heart failure. What was another lab I wanted to talk about? BNP, that's really a big one, indicative of heart failure. Okay. Holter monitoring. So Holter monitoring is important for patients who maybe have angina. Whether it's stable, unstable, or Prince Metal angina. Because what this can do, as you can see here, this is a picture of a Holter monitor. It can be worn on a patient. It's supposed to be worn 24 hours, and it can be worn under their clothes, and it's gonna have this continuous EKG monitoring. What the patient needs to do is, it's going to store this data, it's gonna store their EKG, and as they start to have chest pain, they need to write down the time they had the chest pain and what they were doing. And then what can happen from that is the physician can take that EKG printout, and they can match it up with what the patient's activities were and what was going on, and it can kind of give them a better idea of the angina, better idea of what's causing any abnormalities in their EKG. But that's basically Holter monitoring. This patient, or this picture, should help you remember. While we're on this one though, let's talk about EKG placement. So for our 5-lead EKG, now as you guys know, I don't like mnemonics, okay? The reason I don't like mnemonics is because I believe that if you understand the process, if you understand what's going on, you're going to better understand and remember forever the process and exactly what's going on. So as you can separate learning mnemonics from learning the systems and the processes, I think you can better understand. However, for EKG placement, I think that there's a very easy way to remember the mnemonic because it's just color-based. So we want to have our white one, we have our green one, black, red, and brown. So the best way to remember this is white on right. Okay, so white on right is the first thing to remember. We have white on right. And then you'll do snow over trees and smoke over fire. Okay, so white is snow, right? Green is the color of trees. Black is the color of smoke, and smoke comes out over fire, right? As there's fire, smoke rises over fire. So white on right, and snow over trees, white over green, and smoke over fire. And then our brown is our ground, and that's gonna go right in the middle. All right, so that's the best way to remember 5 lead EKG placement. Last thing we wanna talk about here is cardiogenic shock. So what happens with cardiogenic shock is the heart is unable to maintain effective cardiac output. This can be due to various reasons, heart failure, disruptions in the cardiac function. And so what we're gonna see, so shock, what we need to understand really quickly though, shock is a decreased delivery of oxygen to the body. And so as oxygen delivery is decreased and is affected, our organs are not gonna be able to function appropriately. Okay, so it's not necessarily low blood volume necessarily. What it is decreased delivery of oxygen to the tissues, and then the tissues are not able to function without that oxygen. So what happens with our heart is, for whatever reason, our heart is not beating as it should. It's not maintaining effective cardiac output. Okay, cardiac output is volume of blood out in 1 minute, okay? So some of the assessments we might notice with this are gonna be low urine output. Why is that? Well, we're not delivering enough oxygen to our kidneys, or enough blood to our kidneys, so the kidneys are not able to work appropriately. We're gonna have low urine output. Low BP, obviously low cardiac output. The thing we want to assess most with this is our CVP. Okay, the reason we assess CVP is that what that tells us is it tells us the right atrial preload. And what right atrial preload basically tells us is it tells us the overall volume in the system. Okay, the system is our body. Okay, because what CVP is CVP tells us right atrial preload basically. And so it's really gonna tell us the preload in the right side of our heart. Okay, and if we know the preload of the right side of our heart, we basically know about how much volume is kind of in the system. So what is preload? Preload is gonna be the stretch as the ventricle fills up, okay? So as the volume comes in, the stretch, the pressure exerted on those as the volume fills up. Normal CVP is gonna be 2 to 8 millimeters of mercury, okay? So if you have a very high CVP, that means that's gonna be indicative of like hypervolemia, etc. If we have a low CVP, that means we have a decrease in volume, okay? So a CVP less than, you know, 2 or hovering around there is gonna be indicative of low volume. Okay, so that might mean that we need to supply more volume. However, if we have a CVP of greater than like 6 or 8 or so, that's gonna mean we have high volume, and volume is not our problem, okay? So if the patient is ventilated, you wanna take it at end expiration, and then you're gonna zero the transducer at the 4th intercostal space along the mid-axillary line. And that's the location of the right atrium. Okay, where is that at? So mid-axillary line is here under the armpit, and you're gonna want it at the 4th intercostal space. And you'll have a little transducer. So this will be going like in our jugular. And then we're gonna end up with these waveforms. And we want that to be 2 to 8 millimeters of mercury. Okay, and that's gonna tell us our CVP. Hopefully that makes a little bit of sense about cardiogenic shock. We'll go into shock in greater detail later, but that's really kind of what you need to know. You don't need to know a lot about shock for the NCLEX. If you start working in the ICU, this is gonna be a topic you're gonna wanna come back to and visit quite often. If you have any questions, you guys, let us know. Those are some of the quick NCLEX points that